Welcome everyone to Safari Live. You're on board now with Wium and Sam. Rebecca and Geraldine will be in director's seats. It is the 17th of May, it's my birthday, and I'm feeling quite excited. It's 16 degrees Celsius and 61 Fahrenheit, so it's a little bit nippy this morning, but nothing too bad. I haven't got my beanie on, so I should be fine. We've just come down towards the Sydney's Dam sort of area because we heard lions down by the Jumet Dam and we're just checking for tracks in this area. But we also thought, let's go and see if those hyenas could be active this morning. So we're going to drive and bumble softly into this area and see if we can see those hyenas. So let's go nice and gently to the hyenas this morning. On the other vehicle will be Brent. So Brent is out driving around Zoe's road and Rebecca's to see if he can find and locate on any tracks of the lions that they heard last night. You got a track there?
Going down the firebreak, yeah.
Okay, so we've got some tracks going down the firebreak. Let's just quickly see here if those hyenas are active. This could be, I haven't seen yet the hyena den active for quite some time. So let's just take 2 seconds to see if they are active. Here we are. So let's be quiet and see what might be here. Aaron, Aline, James Richard, and many, many, many others, thank you so much for your birthday wish. You say that you wish that the animals can come for our birthday today. I also hope so. I'm just having a look here to see if there are any hyenas that want to join it. Doesn't look like they got invited to the party. There's nothing there. No worries. Let's go follow up on those tracks and potentially we might be able to find something. Let's go to Sydney's Dam. I'm sure there'll be something lurking around there. Maybe the hippopotamus. The infamous hippopotamus. And it's still quite early, so if we're lucky and we're paying attention, we might just see a hippo outside of water, which is always a very exciting thing to see. So the sun has not arisen yet on the 17th of May. So maybe, am I still 25? No, I was actually born at 8 o'clock in the morning, so I'm still 25, everyone. When 8 comes in, then I'm really 26, officially. So yeah, big happy birthday, Tom. If my brother is watching, I think, I hope he is. Happy birthday, Thomas. Welcome to being 26. Let's see how life treats us on this next year of life. Where were those tracks here?
Right here.
Heading west?
No.
Heading east? Okay, cool, let's follow this track. If we go down here and we go down towards Buffelshoek cut line, we might also be going close to Kojima's territory, which would be also quite cool to see if we could find Kojima. But in essence, you know what the greatest thing about being out in the bush is that you start every day, every morning you wake up, you know, whether it's today, tomorrow, yesterday, and it's an open canvas, much like every day in life. And anything that might happen, you just have no idea what will happen. Teresa Anderson is saying a wild dog sighting would be quite a nice fit to my birthday. Yeah, whenever it comes, I'll be so happy, Teresa. But a wild dog sighting would be spectacular. A little bit of action from the morning would be great. So drag marks it. What direction? Okay, so we picked up on some drag marks. You can hear some arrow mark babblers in the background there. There's the drag mark. Well done, Vildi. Here it is, and it's going up there. So let's go around. Maybe there's something in the bushes there. But it could also, that I think that could also be, the wildebeest was killed here by those hyenas not so long ago. I don't know if you guys remember that. I don't know if that could also be part of the drag marks. No, so Vildi doesn't think so. And I was with Vildi yesterday morning when we found those lionesses. So that could, it could very well be the same lionesses that are in the area now. We're just gonna drive around the perimeter just to see if those drag marks come out the other side, which would be quite interesting to see. Let's go and have a look. I can't see anything at the moment. So I think that those, that lioness pride that we saw yesterday was the Mangani pride. And I posted a thing on my Rewild page on Facebook just to update everyone who might be interested on who the Mangani pride is and the Salada breakaways. And you can read up about them. It's fascinating. I used to be with them when I was at Londolozi in the south. So have a look at them and see if you are interested in learning a little bit about them. In the meantime, we'll have a look for them. If we don't find them, we'll just go look at Sydney's. And in the time being, let's go and see how Brent is doing on this wonderful morning. Good morning and welcome to the Sunrise Safari. It is a mite bit chilly. As you can see, I lost my big mitt and I had to steal one of Jamie's little mitts. And I can definitely say that this one is warmer than that one. I've got Dangerous Dave on camera, and we're in search of some lions that were all around. So we've done a big loop. There are no tracks going through here, but that's good. That means we're going to head down towards the Mulati River, check Twin Dams area, maybe check a little bit further east towards Buffelshoek. So hopefully, I'm still quite confident that they're on Juma. Of course, our plan will change if we find any leopard tracks, but for now, we're looking for lions. And put that hand in my pocket, it's warmer there. So winter's definitely upon us now, and it's much colder this morning, and the main reason for that is that there is literally not a cloud in the sky at all. So what the clouds do, they do insulate the ground a little bit, so all the warm air rising off the ground during the day gets caught by the clouds and forms a little bit of a warmer layer. But when you have these crystal clear mornings like today, there's none of that insulative layer. And I am slightly regretting not wearing boots this morning and wearing sandals. So even my feet are a little bit cold. But hopefully it will warm up not too long. But of course, the best thing to warm all of us up is to find a kitty cat. And of course, a happy birthday to Sam Wise out in the other vehicle. And as I said to him last night, he's now too old to be young and too young to be old. So he's catching up with the rest of us, although I think, unfortunately, the way age works, it's a race. The rest of us are always going to win. And James is, of course, streaks ahead of the rest of us, but well, not that much. So you'll notice I'm driving quite quickly this morning, and while it's cool and cold like this, and I'm on trying to find cats, I will be moving quicker than say later in the day, and that's because I'm trying to find the tracks of the cats and find them moving rather than snoozing. Thank you.
that now. That wasn't the lion, Jack. You know, heard of Ellie's three here, so. As great as it is having all the elephants around at the moment, they can make tracking a little tricky from time to time. Apart from lions on the Juma Dam cam, Chris Rogue says she heard a leopard sawing during the night. Well, Chris, I will definitely be keeping my eye open for leopard tracks. I haven't seen a leopard since I've been back from leave. Seen lions, seen cheetah, but no leopard, and I think this is definitely a great morning to rectify that. So while we continue in search of big cats, Sam is with the other dominant predator at Juma.
So I decided to come down Sandy Patch for a second just to see what might be going on. And the hyenas have been found. There's two just in front of us here, and there's two that are running in the distance down there. So I'm trying to work out what's going on. There's actually three down there. So they're all running in different directions. Potentially the lions had killed something last night and something's going on around that area. Let's go and see those hyenas quickly, because it looks like they're moving in a different direction. I just want to see which way they might be going. Here are the two hyenas, they're right here. Here we go. There's one hyena. I'm just gonna switch my lights off. There's the other one. Let's see which way it goes. It looks like they're running down towards Sandy Patch. I'm just gonna get my binoculars out and see which direction that other one is going in. This could be the youngsters from the den. It's very, very exciting. There's one just in front there that's walking past. I'm just watching the distance, and there's four of them, and they're all walking down towards a specific place as if they're smelling something. Right, let's reverse. And let's go and follow this one. Maybe this one will carry on down the road and give us a little bit more evidence to the direction in which the hyena would like to go. So this one might be going off to the den. Okay, so there goes this one. There's another one down there. You can just see them there now going down into the thicket. There's three of them there. Interesting interaction there between the two hyenas in the distance. There's the third one. Looks like there's a little bit of play between them. So this is exactly what happened yesterday morning before we went live. There were three hyenas just ran past us straight into the thicket, and then we couldn't find them again. So it's awesome to be with you as we've seen them this morning. I'm just trying to, there goes the other one. So three have gone down into the thicket, one's ahead of us. We're gonna do our best to try and stick with them this morning, as they will show us evidence to what might be going on. I can't see the other ones anymore. But let's get behind this one and see which way this hyena would like to go. There it goes, it's not running. A Well, there's some impala just over there. They can quite clearly see the hyena that's walking there. See, now they've all made a noise. So the impala here, you can see them. I'm just turning around so that we might be able to see that hyena again. So it's quite thick here, so the impala are going to be moving off there. Let's turn around and go and see what's happening. How exciting is this, everyone? We've had some active hyenas. Just have a look down there to see if you can see them. Have a look for any movement that might be in the bush there. I'm just going to try and get to a point where we might be able to see the openness of this area. So our best option now is to either wait for them to come out or to drive around the other side to see which way they're going. And down there is the cut line, Sibambili cut line. So maybe the lions have killed something last night and then they crossed over and they've just come back to the den. Just looking in every direction because they could easily come popping out. Oh, this is so exciting to wake up to these hyenas running around like this. It's almost like wild dogs. Nancy's saying, I wish we could find their current den. That could be interesting. I would love to see if I could find their current den. So I can't see them down there. Let's make a quick drive down here and make a little circuit. Potentially there's something else on the road, and hyenas will flush other animals out. So let's go in the direction that they were walking in. But what was fascinating is that they were actually coming in this direction. They were going that way when we saw them for the first time. And then they changed direction. They just changed their direction and went back in a westerly direction, which is interesting. So they can so easily change their direction when hyenas are moving around. Much like the wild dogs, they're also very, very difficult to predict in terms of what direction they would like to move in. So now we're just searching through here to see if we can see them come out anywhere. Can't see them at the moment. Let's carry on. Did you watch the way they run? They've got a very, very distinct. There's nothing down there. There we go, there's one. So I'm going to follow it. Here it comes. It's coming right towards us. It looks like one of the youngsters. Look at the way it walks. Fascinating to watch the way in which hyenas walk. They've got quite a slanted back, as you can see. Strong, powerful jaws. There it goes. It's going towards Sydney's Dam. I can't see any other hyenas that are following this young one. There it goes. Here he goes. Now, you normally just find hyenas sitting at the den site. You don't often just see them running around like this, especially in the early hours, because they are nocturnal animals. So to see them moving around in these early hours is just fantastic. So there goes the one hyena running towards Buffelshoek. I'm just looking in the distance where the other ones could come. There's nothing there. So it's just this hyena that's loping. So there goes that hyena into that thicket there. Who knows what he or she will be doing. But you can quite clearly see that little run into the distance. I'm very excited that we managed to see that. Let's, while we go see if we can find the other hyenas, let's go and see how Steph's doing in this bushwalk.
Morning from the bushwalk this morning. It's myself, Stefan Vinterburg, and I've had a weekend away with my family, and I'm back now for a week full of walks with you again. I'm very excited, actually. Quite a chilly morning this morning, I must be honest. Winter seems to be creeping back into the air a lot faster than what I remembered from last year, but of course that happens every single year here in the bush, and it's just one of those things that we have to get used to. But to kick it right off, we've got a surprise for James Richard, who last week asked us to show you a white-tailed mongoose, and we found a white-tailed mongoose track. They're not the most common things to see out here. Their tracks are quite common, but the actual animal is not that common. So what we're looking at it here is we're looking at a set of tracks. It would be made up of a back foot and a front foot. Here we've got the front foot track, and I know it's a mongoose track because of three things. One is the elongated toes. The toes are not round, they're actually quite long, like beans. Second thing is these very long claws. There's the point of a claw there, and here's the end of the toe. You can imagine that that claw is this long, almost inch long claw that's quite heavily recurved, and they use that for digging out the insects and the prey that they eat. And the third thing on the back of a mongoose track is the plantar pad. This particular pad here at the back of the track, in this track, not that evident until I take a piece of grass and I put a piece of grass over the track. And what it should give us is it should give us a slight slant. I'm putting it to the back of the track, and there's the direction of the track, like that. And as you can see, the plantar pad is off at an angle to the direction of the track, and that is quite typical of mongoose tracks. Their plantar pad, or this part of their pad, is not even like mine would be. This part of the pad is actually elongated out slightly, and you can see that. So this part of the pad would be elongated slightly out to this part of the pad, and that you can see when you put a piece of grass, like I've done over here. You've put a piece of grass there and in the direction of travel there. In my hand, it's perpendicular. In the case of this mongoose, it's at an angle to the direction of travel. There you go. And that, Mr. Richards, is the white-tailed mongoose track. That's what I've got. But I've got another thing for us today. As you'll notice, for those of you who watched the show last week and over the last year, I normally carry a backpack with my binoculars here, and today I haven't got that on. And that's because we have a very special addition to the Bushwalk team starting today, making his debut for the first time. We have got Hubert. Come stand here, Mr. Hubert. Hubert is Juma's latest game scout and latest addition. Very nervous still in front of the camera. Hubert essentially is going to be taking over my role as security detail for the walks. Hubert is a very gifted tracker. How many years have you got in the bush now, Hubert? Wait, come stand here with me. 16 years. So Hubert and I share a similar time in the bush. I got 17 years, Hubert's got 16 years. In our industry, we are dinosaurs in this industry. Generally, people only stay 2 to 3 years in this industry. Anyway, Hubert, his skill sets range in terms of tracking, which mine definitely are lacking. And so what we've done, what Juma's very kindly done, is employed Hubert to give some depth to our bushwalk team. And you'll be looking, well, we'll be looking forward to using Hubert more often. You'll be seeing him trying to hide away from camera, similar to how I have. And he'll be doing that over the next weeks and months to follow. Thanks, Hubert. Good luck for your new position, eh? Alrighty. So, now, Cara's made an observation on my lack of suitable attire, and as you can see, Cara, I'm getting quite chilly now at the moment, and that's because I have almost always learned that I carry a jacket. I'm okay and warm for the first 5 or 10 minutes of the walk, and until we get a little bit of exercise going, and then I start to overheat, and then the jacket just becomes a liability. You've got to put it somewhere, it gets snagged on bushes, you've got to carry it in a bag, making it lumpy and uncomfortable. And so I choose not to wear a jersey and comfort later on in the walk rather than comfort earlier on in the walk, which you'll notice a bunch of my colleagues are not like. Jeandre, funnily enough, also doesn't have much on today. I think it's limited to 3 pieces of clothing and his shoes. And him and I share a similar bit of a shiver every now and again. What we're going to do is walk into the sunrise now, not only because it's very pretty, but because there were some lions lying at the Juma Pan last night. And this morning we had a bunch of buffalo bulls right at the entrance to our camp. Ah, a lot of people are saying welcome, Hubert. So a lot of viewers saying good luck and welcome. And so what I want to do is go and look for where these lions came from. We're immediately going to throw Hubert into the deep end by asking him to track these lions on the bushwalk today. But as you know, the focus on these bushwalks is to try and discover the things that we don't see from the cars. And we do that very, very well out here, I must be honest. One of the things we get to do is to enjoy sunrises like you've got happening over my shoulder over there. And we'll walk for a bit and then we'll stop and we'll enjoy that sunrise as we carry on. I quite enjoy these sunrises, you know. On clear autumn days like we have today, they tend to be one of the most beautiful events. It's these soft, very orangey, purple, mauve glows, and then it turns into the most brilliant orange, which we're going to be lucky enough to see if Jeandre doesn't fall over the bush that he's on. We can sit here and we can enjoy the sunrise, I think. So Debbie, while we wait for the sunrise and watch that, has asked me what chameleons do in winter. Do they slow down and do they hibernate? Absolutely. They absolutely do slow down and hibernate. And the reason for that is they're cold-blooded. Cold-blooded animals, they get their metabolic energy from the temperature of the environment. And because the days and the air is very cold, and they operate in quite a narrow band, it's not quite as narrow as we are. We're at 37 degrees, that's our metabolic temperature. And we must keep it that way, but our body burns energy to keep us there. Their metabolic range is almost 10 degrees, which is astounding. What that means is that chameleon can only operate in that 10 degrees. So they use sun, shade, deep shade, water, underground, under bark, to moderate this temperature so that it keeps them burning energy or not burning energy when there's not that much food around. To answer in conclusion to your question, they absolutely slow down, their activity periods will become much less, and in some cases when there's a low insect yield, like this year for instance, I fully expect us not to see chameleons all the way until probably, let's say October again, when it starts to warm up and insects start to come out again. So I don't expect to see many chameleons this winter. You do get the activity periods are very short, restricted to the hottest times of the day, and they will most likely be in cover during game drive times. But have a look. The sun has crested. So the beginning of a bright new day. One of the big benefits of winter is that we get to see sunrise. So often in summer, by the time we get going, the sun has actually already risen. We're rushing to get ready with the sun rising here at 5 to 5 or 10 to 5, some unearthly hour of the morning. A little bit more civilized in winter, it gives us some time to appreciate it a bit more. As you can see, not a lot of dust in the atmosphere. The sun is bright and shiny, and there's very little nimbus around the sun. The more dust, or the later we go into the winter, the more dust will appear, and the greater the nimbus will become. In other words, the more diffused the light will become. But for today, it is bright and shiny, and while we're trying to get the sun out of our eyes and try and find out where these lions have gone, we are going to link through to Brent.
So we're heading away from the sunrise, and we've done a big loop. We've checked through the Mawati River up towards the Buffelshoek waterhole. No sign of the tracks coming out here of those lions, which is a positive. So what that means is now we've sort of ruled out that they might have crossed through to the east. So we're now checking the northern boundary back towards the Juma Dam camp. And so basically we're making our circles smaller as we try and close where these lines are. Chilly this morning. Make sure no tracks over here. Nope. So I think the last time they were heard, we heard them roaring, was probably around 4:30-ish. Nothing since then. Tracks there. So of course we are hoping that they do make another noise. And with Stef being out on foot, that's great, because he'll be able to hear it much more easily than we will driving. And he can help us get in the right area. Now there's a possibility overnight that the lions are being chased by elephants or whatnot. Sorry, just on the game drive. Morning, F. There was Ingala around where Teller last night. I'm still trying to follow up on where Nkonzo's gone. Sam's got 130 Nkonzo around Sydney's dam. And that's it for the morning so far on Buya Teller. Thanks. So an update from Ephraim, apparently four Birmingham boys and one female, not sure which female, but in that area more than likely a Styx female, have caught a buffalo to the south of southeast of us on Chitwa Chitwa. Now, have the Nkahumas done their flying trick? Hopefully not. What's the sign of Eddie everywhere? Oh, Sarah Wood's wondering which of the animals out here have the best sense of smell. Well, I suppose it depends. Most of them have a phenomenal sense of smell in comparison to us. But I think probably hyena, because they rely on their nose a lot to find a meal. And then maybe elephants, I think, will also have a very good sense of smell. For some reason, I feel the hyena will be top of the smell meter or the smell-a-thon competition. Okay, now, still no tracks. Okay, so we're gonna head down towards the Juma Dam cam at the moment, and maybe check along the northern side, maybe through to the Gallagher pad. You never know what might be around. Make sure we don't have any tracks here. Ooh, nothing yet. Maybe they didn't move too far after being seen on the dam cam. Hello. Morning, madam. Seen any lions? Doesn't look like it. See how she looks a lot darker in the cold morning. She's erected all her fur to catch a little layer of air between her body and her fur, creating a nice little insulative blankie. And you'll notice a lot of the antelope species do that on these very cold mornings. quite the mystery to where these lions could have disappeared to. I do realize it is around midnight in the Northern Hemisphere, and those hardcore Safari Live addicts who are up, send us some questions. And if you're not sure, you've just found us, you can send questions to the email address questions@wildearth.tv, or use the hashtag SafariLIVE on Twitter. So if you've ever wondered anything about the African bush, now is your chance to ask. It's going to be a glorious morning, and I won't lie, I'm quite excited for that sun to pop over the horizon, warm us up a little bit. But I think it's going to be an hour or so before we're getting any decent warmth off the sun. We go check very carefully around Vuyatela Lodge. Let's go see what Sam is up to on his birthday safari.
Welcome back, everyone. We've had quite an exciting morning. We drove, we had those hyenas for quite some time. We found some tracks that were heading off into Simambili, and now we have then found some male leopard tracks. It looked like Tingana could be in the area. We followed the tracks towards Sydney's dam, and then they just left and went off into the thicket, we presume. So what we decided to do is just do a loop to see if there's something maybe running out of the bushes here, or potentially some more leopard tracks on the firebreak closer to Sydney's. So it's been an interesting morning so far. We've also seen lion tracks, but they could also be the lion track. We saw lions in this area yesterday. So there's a whole bunch of things going on at the moment. We're going back to Sandy's Patch and driving ourselves around. And how cool was it to see those hyenas outside of the den moving around and playing? And it was just such a fantastic thing to see, especially in the open area, because we had quite a lot of space to see quite a lot, which is just great to see that. I think that Brent is also close by, so he's going to be following up on tracks around Vuyatela. There's two impalas that look like they... It looks like two male impalas that are having a little fight there. Let's get a little bit closer and we can view them a bit better. So we're still in the rut. The rut is still happening. So may the rut continue. There we go. Put a little bit of an interaction between... I'm going to go here. I don't want to disturb them too much. So those are two male impala. There just looks like a little bit of dominance between the two. We might just see the clash of horns there. The one is backing off. So one is pushing the other one away. As we can see here, this is... There we go. He's putting his horns down. Get in a position where interesting, now the other one's moving backwards. What? So they might just lock horns. Just gonna come through a little bit closer. So male impala, especially during this time, are at their weakest point at this stage because they have to fight a lot between other males. So it makes it much easier for lions and leopards to catch and prey on them. This is fascinating though, because that the one on the right was actually pushing the other impala away, and now the reverse has happened. Look at this, it's really, really interesting. He's backing away completely. Are we going to see the lock of horns? You can see the frustration between the two there. And he's not backing away. I mean, he's backing away, but he's not moving away from the encounter. He's still saying, I'm still part of this. But just moving back slowly. So it seems like a lot of threatening here. You can hear the sound of the crested Franklin making quite a noise around us at the moment. There they go. So they've moved right around us now. I'm just going to reverse a bit so that the aerial is not so in your way there. I'm going behind the bush now. So you can imagine this must tire them out quite a bit. Oof. They've seen something? What are they looking at? Back. See that, you hear those noises, that almost like a bark that they're having against each other there. So the thicket's back in our way. I think it's best to go the other side now because it looks like the other impala is starting to show a little bit more dominance. There we go. We just heard the sound. And so it's actually quite nice sitting in this area because this is where the hyenas were last seen, in this area. So potentially hyenas could come running out of the bush. Here we go. So it's a proper standoff between the two. And it seems that, you know, when they show, sometimes they'll be fighting to get each other stronger and bigger, but I think that's mainly between April and March. And in May is when they start courting those females. So I can't see any females around us at the moment. I just see two males fighting over this open area. See, there's no attention being made to any predators around there. It's just a fight between the two males. Backing off. You can also see quite clearly also now that difference in coloration from the top to the bottom there. So they've puffed out their little coats this morning because it is quite chilly. So they've now gone back behind the bush. So this will continue for quite some time now. But Red is saying they do seem quite easily distracted. Yes, Red, they do. They are not paying attention to any hyenas that might be running around. That's why it's quite interesting sitting with them. But there doesn't seem to be much activity. So we're going to drive back in this way. These impala are probably going to sit like this for quite some time, pretty much maybe the whole day. They'll keep looking and asserting dominance on one another. So let's continue down Sandy Patch to see if we can locate on those, either that male leopard tracks that we saw earlier, or see if we can find some hyenas that are on the run. Potentially, maybe the den is looking quite active. So let's go and have a look. Imagine going and fighting all day. That's what these impalas were going to be doing all day. So they get very, very tired. So if there is a leopard in the area, a leopard will take advantage, and we know that there's a leopard in the area because VM and I just jumped out the vehicle and followed leopard tracks for about 3-4 minutes. and we noticed that they were heading in that direction. So we're going to drive Sandy Patch, have a look on the trees, the termite mounds, anywhere possible for the sign of something that might be moving around. And it'll definitely be worthwhile just going to the den, the hyena den, but later to see if they're coming back down to sleep for the day, because they are nocturnal animals, hyenas. Just keep looking around to see if we can see anything in these thickets. So we're going to continue down this road to see if we can find anything. Let's go to Stef and see what he's looking at.
We're coming down this game path, and what Jeandre and I are immediately noticing is there's tracks of a massive bull elephant, but a really massive elephant. And I'll show you how we look for those tracks. Right where we're standing now, a little bit tough to see, but if you look about 10 meters or so, 10 yards or so down the pathway, you'll see there's quite a sandy patch, quite a lightly sandy patch. In the middle of that sandy patch, you're going to see a section of the soil there that's almost shining, and that's where that elephant track is. And I'm fully expecting us, when we get there, to see this elephant. I'm just getting glimpses of his size just from his pad, but it's there that I want to go and show you, and it's there that I'm expecting that we're going to be seeing this big track. And just to give you an idea, his foot is probably filling this game path, and here he is, just as we expected. I'm going to be picking up a stick so that I can show you what I'm talking about. But this is his front foot, from here to here. And I know it's his back foot. And I know it's his back foot because it's oval. As you can slightly draw the outside, there to there. That's his front foot. And I'm going to give you some scale of size here. I'm a size 9 and that's my foot here. So there's my foot and I'm a size 9. He's at least a size 18, to give you an idea of where that is. So a size 18 back foot. Let's go to this, because this is actually the more impressive of the two. This is his front foot right here, and his front foot goes from here to here, where the front of his toe is actually scooped out the sand. That's actually his toenail over there. And his track is just enormous. Have a look at this round track, because this is his front foot and he carries all of his weight. At least 60% of his weight is carried on his front foot, so it's nice and dished and round. And I know that he's going in the direction down the path, because the back of his foot is similar to the back of your heel. It's worn smooth, and you can see how the back here is worn with significantly less ridges than this area of his foot, which is see where the cracks in his foot have come. Now, there's a rule of thumb that will allow us to judge the shoulder height of this particular elephant. What you do is you start to the circumference of the track, and I'll just draw it out for us. And then you measure that. And we can measure that 3, 4, 5, 6 times. So 6 of these sticks, and we times that by 3.5. So what did that give us? 24. So 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. I only get to 7. Now we need to do 24 of those to be able to get to his top of his shoulder. Now, obviously it's just a rule of thumb. 24 of these is going to take us to the top of the next tree. But an elephant that is around about this size is probably going to be close to about 3.5-4 meters at the shoulder. And 4 meters, I'm only 2 meters tall. Less than 2 meters, I'm 1.8 meters tall. So you can imagine an elephant that's 4 meters tall, it's on top of my head plus some. That's how big this guy is. A truly enormous bull elephant. That's what this is. Ah, and Michelle, who's a new viewer, welcome to the show, Michelle. I'm glad that you love elephants. I love elephants too, and especially big bull elephants like this. We've seen an influx of these big bull elephants into this area over the last couple of weeks. The reason for that is that as we start moving into the dry season, elephants will start coming back to traditional feeding areas where grass and where woody species of plant are more prevalent than where they enjoy going during the summer. And especially bull elephants like to go into the grass fields of the Eastern Kruger National Park. And then when those grass fields start to die out, they move into the more woody sections. And as you can see from where we are here, there's a lot of woody species of plants. And these big bull elephants come and spend winter or the dry months in these areas where there's lots of wood. So welcome to the show, Michelle, and I hope that that answered that question for you. Now, let's carry on going and see where this big elephant walked. So you can follow, a good idea when you're busy tracking stuff on foot such as you follow these footprints. You don't follow them at your feet, you follow them with your head up. And as you can see through this sandy patch, you can actually see his tracks. I'm going to step on them so that you can see. There's one here, one there, one there. This is his front legs, by the way. There, 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 there. That's how wide his front legs are. Can you believe it? I almost have to jump from footprint to footprint. And we're going to see where he's walked. He seems to... I can see his tracks going here. Elephants are actually notoriously difficult to track on foot, to believe it. The reason for that is that their pads of their feet leave so little disturbance in the soil that when you get to an open patch like this, it's almost anybody's guess where they went to. Luckily for me, he's too big to walk through that big thick bush there in the background, and we're going to be picking one of these game paths and see where he comes out. And Dina wanted to know, am I saying is it a bull elephant because of the size of his tracks? Absolutely, Dina. That's exactly what I'm making my basis on there, is the size of his tracks. Elephant tracks, elephant female tracks, are probably a quarter to half the size of that at their biggest. And so that's how I'm able to deduce that that was a male elephant. Now, he didn't walk down here. It's quite evident that there's no elephant tracks going through that space over there. What we'll do now is we'll walk to the other game path and we'll see if he came out over there with a short detour to find out what this is. Now, we've got some wet urine here, as you can see here. That's a urine patch. Very full of very full of ammonia, that one. And it's probably from what came out of here. Now, evidently, I'm not actually being able to tell what came out of here, to be honest. It's just a bit of a deep hole. I'm going to take a chance and say that we've been here for a bit, and if there was something in there, it would have run out already. So it's not going to be a warthog. However, it's always a good thing to be a bit cautious with warthog. The reason being is they come flying out of their holes like this, and they can actually be quite dangerous. They come out tusks first. And when they come out of a hole tusk first, if I was standing where I was standing, the first thing they're going to do is slash their head from side to side. And those tusks are at the level of my femoral artery. So a lot of people who don't take care with warthog get slashed on the inside of their legs by those tusks as that warthog exits their burrow. This, I don't actually know what it is. The only fresh track that I've got is this one here. And that looks like a warthog. And he exited here, this one here. But judging from that urine at the end of my stick, it is a massively concentrated bash of ammonia that's coming out here. You can see it on the end of my stick over there. Oh, and it's really powerful. I've never smelt anything like it in my life. Smell there, Jeandre. And that probably means that this animal is extracting the most moisture that it can from its food. And when it extracts the most moisture it can from its food, they get these pungent urines. And I'm going to say that that's probably not a warthog because of that. Warthog are hindgut fermenters. They are water dependent. They use a lot of water. Oh, and that's probably a civet or I don't know what that is. Gee, we're going to have to find some tracks there of something. Come back to that hole and see what it is. So back to the elephant. Here he walked over here. So I fully expected to see his track here. And here you can see the back of his pad, that very characteristic venation of the cracks at the back of his pad. And he's walked off over here down this game path. There he goes here. And Timmy's Adventures wanted to know from us, hey, do elephants eat all day? And Timmy's, depending on the season actually, to be quite honest with you, in winter they'll eat up to 24 hours a day. So their bodies, big hindgut fermenting animals, they need lots of food in, lots of food comes out. They don't have a very sophisticated digestive system. What they do is they eat a lot of food, they eat a lot of volume of food, and that's what gives them their ability to actually outcompete ruminants, to be quite honest with you, when it comes to that. They eat large volumes of food, poor quality food, but they do need to eat massive amounts of it, and that makes them eat for a long time in the dry season when food is of a poor quality. And they're eating up to 24 hours a day, 24 hours a day from September, October, but in the summertime they will reduce that to only a couple of hours a day. Obviously when the grass is nice and lush, they're eating and getting a full belly quite quickly, and then they'll drop down to between 8 to 15 hours a day of feeding, round about there. But while we carry on looking at this big elephant, Brent has got something that he wants to tell you.
Look at this glorious morning light that is bathing us. So we've jumped around, Steph had some tracks of the lions heading south. So we've come down to the southern boundary to make sure that they haven't departed. Just looking very carefully here. This is a big thoroughfare for the lions. Of these lions, Brian in Philadelphia is wondering, do lioness roar regardless of a male's presence to warn other female prides that this is their territory? Oh dearie, dearie me, that's not what we wanted to see. So Brian, they do, and there you go, here are the tracks. Unfortunately, they are heading south. Out of our traverse area. So they have left the area. So that's very unfortunate. So we're going to keep moving. Maybe we'll get lucky with some leopard tracks. This is the area where Queen Karula has been up and down, so always good to check in the early morning. So we're chatting about female lions vocalizations. So Brian, if you were watching the Juma Dam Cam last night, most of those vocalizations you would have heard were female. It's quite difficult to tell the difference between male and female. Sometimes you can, sometimes you can't. It depends how close you are. But they do vocalize, and it is, as you say, to keep other females out of their home range. Now, of course, like with the leopards, the lion territories are quite porous. So there's no defined line in the sand. There's sort of a general area that will be the boundary between two different prides. So Dina is wondering, do we know for sure that the lioness were at the dam were the impalas? Dina, I don't know. With those pictures from the dam cam, it's very difficult to discern without actually seeing them in person. So I would be lying if I said for sure. I would say it was most likely the impalas, because that area of Juma, we only really see the impalas and very occasionally the sticks there. So we're now just checking very carefully. This is one of a queen gorilla's favorite spots to jump between the north and the south. So Suki Lin is wondering whether there's any news on Krula and her cubs, and I'm hopefully to find some news in the sand. And as soon as I know, you'll know. But I haven't heard, I don't think anyone's seen her for a couple of days. So we always try to check this area at least twice a day. This has been her main thoroughfare in the last month or so. Nothing so far. Just some hyena tracks. I think with Karula, why you gotta check especially carefully, because since she's had cubs, she doesn't really march the roads like she used to. See, she just pops across. So, gotta keep our eyes extra carefully peeled, because we're not looking for a nice long track that follows the road. It's normally just a quick scoot across. But what that does do is, if we do find that track, it does give us a very specific area to check for her. So while we look for one of the mammalian predators, Steph has got an arachnid predator to show you.
Well, while we were busy walking through the bush here, the spider web caught our eye for the simple fact in that it was reflecting the sun quite nicely in. When we came through here to see what spider it is, we've actually been perplexed as to what spider this is. At first glance, it looked like it could have been a golden orb web spider, and then when I started to get closer, I thought it was a nursery web spider. And the reason why I said that is because of this dome of silk that you might be able to see here, this dome of silk that we've got that'll come into focus. You should be able to get it either from that side or from up there. That is very characteristic, this dome, from a nursery web spider. And actually, I was convinced it was a nursery web spider right up until a couple of seconds ago. And the reason for that is that nursery web spiders are they're the only ones that build these domes, firstly. Secondly, we never ever find them in these webs, you know. It's quite rare to find a nursery web spider in attendance in her web. But then what is quite interesting is that this web has been used by a whole host of other spiders, and that's actually why I wanted to show it to you, is that yes, this is an old spider web, probably from a nursery web spider, but at the moment what it's doing is it's giving a structure to smaller spiders to use for their webs. And in actual fact, we found three different spiders using this web, this old web, as their home. And I'm going to ask Jeandre to try and come around this side, show you, Jeandre. The only way that we can see the most prominent of these ones is actually from this side. And you're going to follow my piece of grass. He's actually going to be hidden from you there, Jeandre. You're going to follow my piece of grass. Here is this one's web. And you can see how sticky it is. This is the web of the mercury drop spider, which is a kleptoparasite. I just need to chew the end of this grass off so it gives me a better pointy stick. There, in there, is the mercury drop spider. There, can you see him, John, at the point of my stick? What are we doing by forcing Jeandre to film something that's virtually microscopic is creating much tension in him at the moment. It's very difficult to hold this camera still and do what we're doing at the moment. So we've got the mercury drop spider. We've then got another spider that has since disappeared into a ball of its own making. But what I actually wanted to show you, what's amazing, is not really the spiders. The spiders are quite cool, but we'll find you better mercury drop spiders. But the fact that the spiders are using an old spider web for their spider web, and it's without that spider being there, I just find it amazing. And you still see a whole bunch of this stuff, Jeandre. Got a bunch of different spider silks here. Orb building spiders have 7 different types of silk that they can spin in almost an endless variety of fashions. I mean, for those mathematicians out there, what you can try and do is figure out how many combinations the factor 7 can give you, because they can take a little bit from spinneret type 1 and mix it with a little bit of spinneret type 7 and then throw in any number of different silks, and that gives you a whole bunch of different variations that they use for different things. Now come and have a look at this attachment here. The spider has used this into the stick as an attachment, and this silk is not sticky. This silk is made for strength and has a high elasticity. In actual fact, it has the same strength as stainless steel, but because it's more elastic than stainless steel, it's actually stronger than stainless steel. Can you believe it? Stainless steel of the same thickness. It's the strongest naturally occurring substance on the planet, is this silk. That will then go up into a web of entanglement snares. These are also not sticky, but are much more elastic. So they're not as strong. You can actually break these ones quite easy, but they're not as strong. They're designed to entangle an insect that flies into this and to knock it about. And eventually what will happen is it'll get to the sticky strands. And those are these guys here. And you'll notice when I touch it with my finger, even the slightest touch sticks me to the web. And they create vibrations, as you can see there. The vibrations in the web alert the spider to the presence of prey. She will then come to those vibrations and bite it, envenomating it and starting the digestive process, and then wrap it in a number of different silks. They can wrap it to larder. And I see the little spiders moving on the web. You can see it. And that's just because they're reacting to my finger. Isn't it just amazing? I just find it incredible. So basically this web is designed here to catch insects that are going to be flying, large insects that are going to be flying through the air to land. Designed to catch insects that are flying between trees. These are to catch insects flying onto the tree. Insect flies in, boom, knock, knock, knock into the sticky web at the center. The spider, this nursery web spider, would have lived in this dome. She then would have come through the silk, bitten it, and then larded it and eaten it. And somewhere along the line, she's disappeared, probably with the first of the cold. And then she's moved off. And like I said, after all these years of being in the bush, I actually don't know where nursery web spiders go. You sometimes see them in their webs. Most of the time,
you actually just find the leftover web similar to what we've got here. And that's that for that spider web, basically. Keeping you nice and busy this morning. Now, we're still on the track of this big elephant. He's walked on this game path. And I want to show you what you usually see of tracks. I know that I'm following this elephant because that's a track, believe it or not. So we've gone from that size 18 foot that we were following. This is basically the only sign that an elephant weighing close to tons, what would that be, 13 tons, has left. Just a little patch. But I know that he's gone this way. Oh, and Karasan has asked, are those spiders poisonous? And no, they're not poisonous. The spiders, the nursery of spiders are not poisonous for us. Just trying to help Jeandre over a branch there. Nursery spiders are not, or nursery web spiders are not poisonous for us. Neither are, or venomous to us at least anyway, neither are the mercury drop spiders. You only get four spiders in this country that can do us any harm. They are the sack spider, the violin spider, the button spider, and the desert crab spider. Only those four. Only those four spiders can do us any harm where we are at the moment in this country. Of those, only three we find here. We find the sack spider and the violin spider, and we find the black button spider or the recluse spider. Those are the three that we find in this area. And the difference between venomous and poisonous: venomous is when something can bite you and envenomate you. Poisonous is when something can, is something in itself is quite poisonous. So you get poisonous plants, like mushrooms, for instance. You have to eat it or ingest it. It can then poison us. Venom is something similar to when something bites you and has to inject you with a substance before it can kill you. So you can eat a poisonous spider, you can't, or you can eat a venomous spider, and you can't eat a poisonous mushroom, is basically what I'm trying to get it over there. If that makes any sense this early in the morning, it's a bit, I haven't had enough breakfast yet before my brain starts to cut out. And have a look over here. We're going to follow the tracks of this elephant off here. You're going to quickly go through to Sam, who's got a bird to show you.
Welcome back, everyone. We are now with some crested Franklins. As you can see, there's 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 of them. And they're just running across the road here. Nice to see some crested Franklins, but also in the distance there, we've got a white-back vulture that is sitting on an old knob thorn. Have a look at that white-back vulture, and we have been looking for them this morning because there has been a lot of signs of both male leopard and lions in the area, but it looks like the lions have crossed off, and the male leopard is thick, or deep in a thick bush somewhere down by Sydney's dam. So we're just doing a big loop here to see what we can find, and we came across this wonderful looking white-back vulture. It is quite far away from us at the moment, but we did see, myself and Jeandre were at Arethusa a couple of days ago, and we saw a white-back vulture in its nest. And I did some research, and what's really, really interesting is that they only incubate one egg over the winter season inside that nest. So they'll rear up one chick. And it, you know, also something that I read up that I found really, really interesting with white-back vultures is that when they're in a position where they feel threatened and something's happening, they regurgitate their food up to act it, to make it act as a decoy for other animals. So that's an interesting little bit of defense, to regurgitate and then fly away. So they are quite far. They're probably about, it's probably about 200 meters away from us. And we are heading up Buffelshoek cut line. So the white-back vultures there, maybe it'll be waiting for the thermals, the warm air to then to start rising as that sun rises in the horizon there. And then we'll start seeing vultures flying up into those thermals, and they'll act as our, almost as our, what do you call those cameras, Wium, that fly above us?
Drones? drones?
Drones. They act like almost drones for us because they will be moving around and seeing if there's any kills in the distance. So that will be really, really awesome. So let's carry on a little bit more. Let's go down to Buffelshoek Dam and see what we can find. Potentially we might find some more vultures in the area. And if the day heats up, then we'll have some thermals in the distance. Thermals and vultures flying up. So it was an active morning. We got out and all those hyenas were going absolutely crazy around us. And there's just tracks of all sorts of hyenas and lions that are around, but they're all moved off in different directions mostly. Especially the ones that we saw. The lionesses that we saw yesterday morning moved off into Sibambili, and then they came back and it looks like they've crossed over by twin dams there again. So they crossed over at the night time. I was told that they were seen on the Juma camp. Lucy would like to know, is there any word of the Inkahuma female and her cubs? There's absolutely no word yet, so the last thing I heard was that the Inkahumas were seen with James probably about 3 to 4 days ago, and they were all together and the one was still looking very, very pregnant. But at the moment, there's no word of them, and that's also why I would like to go up towards Buffelshoek, because, you know, I know there's no tracks there. Brent has been there, but you never know. I think that female, that lioness, really, really enjoyed being at Buffelshoek around that area. So she might have just moved off back to that area. Because we saw her it's so strange. We saw her for about a week and a half there, which is quite a lot of time to spend in one place. So we're just driving the cut line, seeing if we can find any more tracks that are crossing the road. And the hyenas went there, so when we saw them this morning, some hyenas went off into Buffelshoek, some hyenas went into Simbambile, and then we went off to the den. This is like 5-6 minutes ago. Wow, look at these tracks. 5-6 minutes ago, and the dens were looking very empty, so they maybe could have found a new den site. So if you look in the road in front of us here, you can see those are large elephant tracks that have moved off onto our property there. So it looks like quite a large elephant has gone off in that direction, which is very, very cool. I know that you studied some elephant tracks with Stef just now, so I thought I should show you that. Ooh, we've got some animals that like to climb trees. Let's go and have a look with Brent.
We go, vervet monkey. Now, they don't like the cold, just like me. So it's not uncommon in these early mornings to find them basking in the sun. Oh, going even higher, getting even more sun. It's a little female vervet. We really want them to start alarm calling at a leopard. That would be very, very nice for us. Oh, looks like it might go higher even. So, some good news. Karula and her cubs have been found, but unfortunately out of our traverse zone in the Mawati River, about 200 meters to the south of our boundary. And she's got an impala kill there, and from what I can hear, both cubs are present and healthy. So what Dangerous Dave and I have decided to do is come have a look at what's happening on Arethusa. Doesn't sound like there are too many cars checking Arethusa, so we could be in for a treat. I do like the vervet monkeys. They always look guilty, like they've just done something wrong or they're about to. Okay. So I'm just listening to the game drive quickly. Have the impala rutting in the distance. Oh, there's a highly mobile hyena in the distance. Really long way away, so just hang with me for a second. Why are you jogging, Mr. Hyena? What have you heard that I haven't? Oh, hold on, Dave. Oop. Ah, there we go. It's a very highly mobile hyena. Jogging down the western edge of the Arethusa airstrip. Maybe he heard leopard catch something. Maybe he heard impala's alarm calling. Oh, we're gonna struggle to catch him at this rate. He's seriously maneuvering. See him, Dave? He's just popped over the ridge there. You've been high. You still see him? Now, in theory, according to some African folklore, oh, decisions, hyena, or a pair of secretary birds. Well, we can try to catch up with a hyena, but look at that. I'm pretty sure they're going to be back here a little later, so I'm still going to go investigate what that hyena, or where that hyena is running, and we'll come back for the secretary bird. Oh, I've lost sight of the hyena. He might have ducked in to the left. Don't see him further down the airstrip. See tracks. Let's go this way. There his tracks are there. Might just switch off and listen for a second. He might have heard alarm calls or something that's prompted him to go investigate, or prompted her to go investigate. Just stop and listen for a second. Morning birds. Oh, we'll definitely have to come have a check. We'll head down towards the river system. I think first, let's go have a look at those secretary birds, because it's definitely not something we see too often. Now, if you have a look, we've just saw that hyena running past. Well, unfortunately, if we show the aeroplane that's sitting here, you'll see there's a very distinct thing around its tires. Let me zoom in. Have a look at that. There's thorn bushes to keep the hyenas from chewing the wheels. Now, hyenas chew lots of different things, and Debbie in Vancouver was wondering why, what do hyenas do at night? Well, they cover vast distance scavenging and looking for potential prey, but they also do hunt. And just give me 1 second. Shanae, Shanae. I wonder where that hyena could have run. I think he was running straight down towards the little river system there, so we'll go check again shortly. Morning, morning. Me too, there's two secretary birds. Yeah, but we're just following hyena, it ran off into the bush there. We didn't see where he went. But yeah, I'm gonna head back towards the secretary birds. So just letting Shanae know that there's some secretary birds. Now, secretary birds are incredible hunters, that. One of their favorite foods, like the snake eagle, is snakes. And they've got those wonderfully long legs with very sharp talons on them, and they kick the snakes to death. They also will kick rodents and lizards and other little creatures. And, oh, excuse me. Thank you, Dave. And let's see. Pretty sure. And, oh, excuse me. So we're around here. Oh, here we go. On a roll. Now, where have they disappeared to? Now, they can walk quite fast. Wait here, let's have a quick look where they've gone. So they were moving from left to right. Let's try to see if we can spot them again. Right on the edge of the short grass. Now, where have they gone? Sit quietly and have a look. Might catch a bit of movement. There's a tawny eagle sitting in that dead tree there. Okay, I don't know where these... Where could the secretary bird go? I don't think they've gone very far. I think they're just behind that wall of trees. So Susie in North Carolina is wondering why we don't see birds breathe like we do other animals in cold weather. So see this, the mist coming out. You will if we're able to put a close enough zoom on. Obviously they're quite a bit smaller, so their lungs are smaller, so it's less obvious. Is highly annoying that these secretary birds have disappeared. Now I'm pretty sure they're going to make their way back out onto this open area a little bit later. So we're just going to carry on for now. Anyway, nice to even just get that little view of them before they jogged into the thickets. Have one last look through the trees, and if nothing, let's go to Stef and see what's happening on Shank's pony.
Have a look at this tropical tent web spider that we found a brilliant example of for you here. And I hear that the questions about spider webs are coming in thick and strong. There you can see the tent web. The entanglement snares above and below. And in attendance is Mrs. Tropical Tent Web Spider herself. She is hiding at the moment underneath this leaf, and I'm going to be putting my grass, a piece of grass there. There she is there, underneath the leaf. I'm sure Jeandre is going to show it to you. A blue butterfrog has asked me, what is the average lifespan of a spider? Generally a season, a blue butterfrog. Generally a season. So generally they will come out at the beginning of our summer and they will disappear and die off again at the end of our summer. So to give it a span, sort of anywhere between sort of 1 and about 6 months, I suppose, at maximum. There are some spiders, old world spiders, that live much longer than that. We have some of our tarantulas, we call them baboon spiders here, and, excuse me, and they can actually live for up to 30 years, can you believe it, 30 years for a spider. But these web building spiders generally just for a season. There you can see a beautiful shot of the tropical tent web spider. She's a female, no, she's a female, because females are the ones that make the webs. Excuse me, I've swallowed a fly this morning. And the males are nomadic. The males will be traveling from web to web to try and mate to the females. So males are nomadic, females are sedentary, they live in the web. And have a look what else we've got. We have got a kleptoparasite at work here. Now how kleptoparasitism works, and Jeandre, you might have to come this side. It's the bum shining from here. What I said about the bum shining is that we've got a mercury drop spider that's managed to steal some of this eastern tent web spider's food. So right here at the end of my web, you're going to be seeing the carcass of a fly. At the end of my grass, I should be saying. The carcass of a fly. And attached to that is the tropical tent web spider. And what she's done, she's so small that she's actually going without notice from the bigger spider below. And what happened here is a fly got stuck. She immediately, what she did was she cut the strands of silk going to the tropical tent web spider, carrying them vibration messages to her. She cut that. That stopped the message basically going to the spider that there was a fly caught in her web. And then this little mercury drop spider was at leisure able to finish this fly that should rightly have gone to the owner of the web. It's called kleptoparasitism, and it's a very clever way of saving a lot of energy in silk production and metabolic waste making webs. The Iris has asked a very interesting question here about how spiders don't stick to their own webs, or how is it possible that they don't stick to their own webs? It's actually different for different spiders, Iris. Some spiders are covered in a fine hair, and that hair actually doesn't stick to their web. Other spiders exude a type of oil, and that oil allows them not to stick to their own web. Other spiders have these comb-like feet, and they just walk on areas of their webs that don't have sticky blobs of glue on them. But it's different for different spiders. It's difficult to give a single thing. I'm not quite sure what it is for the tropical tent herb spider. I would imagine that it's something like an oil or like some fine hairs, because her web is so detailed. It's so precise and so intricate. So delicate is probably the word that I want to look at. She wouldn't be able to move across that web without getting stuck to it somehow. I'm sure that she has some mechanism, either some pads or some hairs or some oil, that allows her to stop actually sticking to her own web. I'm just going to have a look and see there. There's a little kleptoparasite. Ah. James, you want to know, apart from the web making and being nomadic, what are the other ways of telling a male spider or from a female spider? James, good question, that in actual fact, and not a very easy question to answer. I'm going to try and do two things that I know of from there. One is the pedipalps. So in the front of a male spider, all spiders, they have these little legs that are called pedipalps. They're appendages that are actually part of the mouth parts, and they move to help feel food and get food going into the mouth. Male pedipalps are usually much more developed than female pedipalps would be. So when you contrast the two spiders together, male pedipalps would be the ones that are a little bit more elaborate, for lack of a better word. They use these pedipalps not only for food, but the males use it when they're mating with the females. It's with the pedipalps that he will insert his sperm packet into her using these pedipalps. That's one. Secondly is the size. Generally, female spiders are larger than male spiders when put together. So female spiders will be larger than male spiders when put together. And while I'm busy speaking to you, I'm thinking of a third one as well. In some spiders, particularly the wolf spiders, female spiders will carry the egg sac with them. So you'll see that an egg sac will be carried either in the mouth or on the back of the spider or underneath the abdomen. And that will be the female spiders. It won't be the male spiders. So those are three extras that I can think of. I'm trying to think of now something more, and I can't. So those are the five things that I know about how to sex spiders. I hope that answered your question there. There probably are a few more. I just can't remember what they are right now. Jeandre was doing a fantastic job with that mercury drop spider with her fly prey. And now we're busy having a look at that tent web spider, or the tent web design at least anyway. And Laura B, all the way from Alabama, which I'm judging has quite large spiders yourself, has wanted to know, do webs ever catch anything that the spider doesn't intend to catch, little birds or small mammals? And yes, Laura, we do find a spider out here, the golden orb web spider, one of the largest of the orb webs, probably about as big as my hand is, in terms of spider size at least anyway, builds these enormously big webs. And yes, I have seen little birds caught in these webs. I haven't really seen a spider feeding on these birds, but I have seen footage of spiders feeding on birds that have been caught in their webs. The webs are strong enough to catch birds. However, I've never seen one of these spiders eating one of those birds. They don't do it to eat. But then again, there's always that odd thing. And the odd thing is, I have seen footage of these golden orb web spiders actually feeding off of birds that have been caught in their webs. As for mammals, let me just think if one of our baboon spiders. The largest baboon spider that we have out here is called the golden brown baboon spider. Also a baboon spider about as big as my hand, and really capable of catching something even as large as a pygmy mouse out here, or some or other type of baby mouse. So I would say yes, we have got spiders that are large enough in terms of body to catch mammals, although I've never seen it myself. It's not to say it hasn't happened yet, but yes, definitely a possibility. Absolutely, in actual fact. Right, now you might catch the faint sound of a helicopter in the distance. There is a census going on at the moment in the Sabi Sands of some animals. So it seems to be working, the northern Sabi Sands today, and it seems to be working to the north of where we are. Hopefully it'll fly away soon. helicopters tend to make animals quite nervous, to be quite honest with you. And I don't want to be walking around in an area where elephants are being harassed by a helicopter. And I say harassed tongue-in-cheek, it's not really a harassed. They don't tease them that much. It's just elephants get a bit nervous. So Anna Maria's asked a very interesting question. Do baboon spiders have spinnerets to make silk? Anna Maria, I'm going to say yes to that question. All spiders have spinnerets to make silk. They don't all produce elaborate silky webs, but baboon spiders absolutely have silk, and they line their burrows with silk. So a baboon spider's hole is about a meter, at most a meter, in the right substrate. A meter is about this much. Sorry, Jeandre. About this much. Most baboon spiders' holes are about this big, though, and the whole tube will be lined with this silky covering, and when it really rains hard, they can even put a silk roof over the top. Those are two different types of silk they use. Then, to feel the area around them, they will lay out these fingers of silk, trip lines, on the ground around their hole, and that then an animal will trigger and will trigger a strike from the tarantula. So they absolutely do make silk. All spiders make silk to some degree or another. Some are very highly specialized silks. The spitting spiders, for instance, have a envenomated silk that they can spit. You have different types of elasticity and rigidity and stickiness, and there's a number of different types of silk. But yes, all spiders have silk. It just makes them spiders, apart from a few other characteristics. Right, now we're going in through a thicket here, which is going to require Jeandre to do some acrobatics through here. And while he does that, we're going to be crossing over to Sam, who's got a water buck.
So we are just driving down the drainage line here, and we've come across some waterbuck that are very, very close to us. You can see a young calf, a young waterbuck just in front of us here. And its mother must be just to the right of it. And it's quite cold down here. It's very, very chilly, actually. It's all the cold, dense air has moved down towards this drainage line. And we thought, let's drive down here and see what might be lurking around here. So there's more than one here. There's another one that's feeding just to the left of it over there. There's three waterbuck. Have a look at how thick their fur is by their neck there, so that must keep them quite warm. And they don't stray too far away from water, so we'll often find waterbuck in these areas. You can see them grazing over there. Very, very sweet to see a young waterbuck. So I just want to link a story that I had when I was training with a hyena and a waterbuck. I was once driving in the south, at Londolozi, and there was a waterbuck that was running away from a hyena, much like the ones that we saw this morning. And the waterbuck decided its best form of defense. So with most waterbuck, their defense is to jump into the middle of a watering hole. And it jumped, and the young calf went into the middle of that watering hole, but then the hyena actually jumped in after it and killed that young waterbuck. So it's an interesting form of defense that these waterbuck have, but sometimes it really doesn't work, as I saw in that case. But you can quite clearly see the three rings at the back of those three waterbuck there, and I've just caught in the front of my eyes the male that is just down here, so this must be his harem. So let's go very, very quietly down here and see if we can catch up on this big male waterbuck. This is probably my favorite place to be. I really, really wanted to come here this morning, as it feels almost quite ancient down here. So we've got some trees coming out. You can have a look. I mean, just look at these root systems that are on the left here. just looks really, really nice to drive through here. And this is a really nice smell that you get down here. I just thought I would come and share this wonderful drainage line with you all on this morning of the 17th of May. We are nearly at the waterbuck, just around the corner here. Have a look at those horns. They're quite prominent looking. There he goes. Some beautiful jackalberry trees around here. Yeah, this is a jackalberry. Magnificent. You can imagine many leopards like to walk around and climb those trees. So there goes the male waterbuck in the morning light. Just have a look. There he is, look at those horns. And there's some more females here. So quite different to the impala rams that we saw this morning, where they have much curled, more spirals in their horns. These horns come out quite prominently. And to the right here we have the two females. It seems like there's another youngster. So it's nice to come across some waterbuck this morning. And they're off, they must be feeling quite alarmed, because the lions, that pride of lions that we saw at the Juma Dam cam early in the early hours of this morning, would have walked down Twin Dams, which is just here. And so I'm not surprised to see some of these antelopes hiding in the bushes just by the drainage line here. So you can actually see, you can actually pick up on another set of horns just behind the bush here. There we go, you'll see a little bit of movement in a second or two. There are horns there just to the left. So there's something moving behind there. And that looks like, there we go, look at that. It looks like it's even lying in that thick bit of bush there. Those horns are magnificent. So you can just see them moving around there. So those are the waterbuck. We're going to continue down into this area, down through the drainage line, and see if we can find something that might be moving around. I heard that Brent was also following up on a running hyena, so we both had experiences with hyenas running in all sorts of directions trying to catch up with them. And then he came across the secretary bird again, which is very, very exciting. I wonder if he saw them in Arethusa on secretary airlines. Oh, awesome. So Rebecca's just informed me that he did see them at secretary airlines. So this is also one of my favorite trees, just to the right here, which is this jackalberry tree again. Really, really, really beautiful tree. Their woods were often used to build stuff around. They've got quite a hard wood, not as hard as that of the leadwood, which we'll show you in a bit. But what's quite interesting is they used to eat the berries, and the berries were also fermented to make beer and all sorts of fermented drinks as such. And they provide a staple diet for some of the monkeys that jump around there. Blue, I think it was blue butter frog. Was it blue butter frog? That's a really cool name, blue butter frog. You were asking, what is the tree that collects water from the ground? Is that the question, Rebecca? Wow. What's the name of the tree of the branch that can detect water below the ground? That's fascinating, blue butter frog. I think, I'm not too sure on the answer, but could it possibly be a willow tree that does that? I know a willow tree might, but I think it is. It could also be the magic gwari that does that. It could very well be the magic gwari that can detect that. That's truly, truly interesting if it can do that. And I'm going to go read up on that. To detect water below the ground. Wow. Plants really are quite intelligent. Very intelligent, rather. Been here for a lot longer than we have on this planet. So let's carry on through here. It doesn't look like there's anything else in this trailer's line in the thicket. So you've just come on board on our little ship down this little drainage line to see what we could find, and we found a beautiful looking waterbuck with quite significant looking horns. There's some more crested Franklins. They'll be picking on some of these seeds and whatever they can find on the ground here. They're also a very reliable source, well, kind of reliable in terms of looking and hearing the sounds of, or seeing if there's a leopard in the area. So when you hear the sound of a crescent Franklin going bonkers, it could very well be a leopard in the area. And with that, we heard a report that Karula and cubs are doing great. So that's really, really good news, because the last time we saw them, they were hyenas and she was up in the tree with a kill. So it's just really nice to hear that Karula is doing well. All right, let's head up here and see what we might be able to find. Ooh. So the day is starting to heat up slowly but surely. So it's getting close to 8 o'clock, the moment when I was born, on 1990. Who else is a 1990 baby? I'd like to know. I think James Richard is also a 1990 baby. Let's go down Leadwood, maybe we'll find something cool. Let's have a look at this Leadwood. So we had a look at the jackalberry tree. And this is a Leadwood tree, which I also find incredibly beautiful, especially on a sunset. These Leadwoods just look so remarkable in the sunset, and they can stay standing for up to 800 years. So they can live for 500, and for 300 years after they've already died, they should be able to still keep on living. And in those branches and within that tree, many different species of animals would be able to live in there, such as hornbills and squirrels that will run around its bark. Quickly over here while we're on trees is the balanites tree, which you can quite significantly see is fluted. The trunk is quite fluted and it almost has that umbrella sort of look. So it's another beautiful tree. And the seed pod of the balanites was used to ignite flame. So it used to be used as a torch many years ago, when you could get to that seed pod oil and use it as a flame to look around and see where you are going, which is fascinating, isn't it? Imagine living here many, many years ago and having to adapt and use the different things in the bush, from eating the berries of the jackalberry to coming to the balanites tree to see in the dark and protect yourself from lions. I love to bring myself into that sort of imagination, and jeebus, just while we're talking about all the many different things that might live in trees, have a look at this spiderweb nest that's in here. So it looks like quite an inactive nest in there. But I know that Steph was talking about spiders with you this morning, and this is a community spider nest. So I'm not sure if he showed you one of those, but these are quite interesting because they hold a habitat for many, many different spiders that are social. So we do often see them on drive. But I just thought I would also show you again, purely because we've had quite a good lesson between the different spiders this morning from Steph. And those are the only social spiders that we get out here in the African savannah. So let's carry on going. You know what I really, really want to see is you know, a young hornbill that's being reared up by its mother. I've never seen that before. I've only ever read it in books. And this is the beautiful looking acacia knobthorn tree over here. And just to let you guys all know, on my page on Rewild, I actually put up a thing that shows you the different differences between leaf structures of trees that can help you identify. And so this is the knobthorn, and you can quite clearly see some of the knobs that are on the tree there. And the leaf structure of the knobthorn almost looks like Mickey Mouse ears. So if we can go close up on two ends of a leaf there.
That's
That's the closest we can go. So if you look in the distance there, you almost look like you've got two Mickey Mouse ears jumping out there of the knobby knobthorn tree. And this is the tree, Acacia nigrescens, the tree that the giraffe loves to eat. So you can often see giraffe feeding on an Acacia nigrescens. So that was a little bit of a tree lesson this morning. You also see that elephants will ring bark and really take a large chunk of that bark out to get to that cambium layer, especially with those knobthorn trees. As you can see in the distance there, there's a knobthorn tree that's actually died. We'll be driving towards it now. And that actually is ooh, I've just found out from Rebecca that this is my last minute of being 25 years old. Cheapers, what do I want to say to everyone that might still be younger than 25? Whilst being 25, it's been such an epic year being 25. I've really enjoyed it. I've done a lot of traveling. I think 30 seconds left, so I think the best thing is, I feel like I'm doing a wrap up here. Is that maybe be open-minded, take on opportunities, take on challenges, see what the world might open for you. It's just fantastic being 25. It's fantastic to be young. It's also good to listen to the world around you and just be very appreciative and grateful of your mothers, because mothers are such important parts of our life. And that's it. I am 26 years old. Welcome, everyone. Tommy, my brother Thomas, just sent me a message on Twitter saying, "Happy birthday, Sam. Welcome to being 26, and you miss me very, very, very much, Thomas." I must say I miss you very much as well. This is the third birthday in a row that we have not spent together, and we are twins, and we are very close twins at that. And it does make me sad. I woke up this morning and I did feel a little bit sad that I wasn't with any of my family this morning on my birthday, and I haven't been for 3 years on my birthday with my family, which it just did make me quite sad. But at the same time, you know, I'm young, and I'm exploring the world, and I'm seeing what I'm made of, and learning a little bit more about myself, and becoming a bit more independent. So Tommy, I love you very much, my bro. I'll be back home in a couple days' time, and a couple days, just 10 days, and we'll have 2 weeks. I hope that you have a fantastic birthday, my man, and enjoy life, and have a good time with all our friends in Cape Town, and we'll chat soon, my bro. Awesome. So we're going to continue in this direction. We've got elephant tracks going. Let's see what happens in the year of 26 or the morning of being 26. Let's go and find out how Steph's doing. I think he's building something.
We came across this crime scene here. It's of a giraffe. And you know, it's so rare that you find so many bones lying in the same place. And we've been playing around here for quite some time, trying to figure out exactly how these things fit together. And believe it or not, I'm perplexed as to this. I know that this is part of the pelvis. This here is a pelvic bone, because in it we can see the hip joint. And I found part of the femur. This is the femur, because here's the bull joint. And that would have fitted in there like that. So you got the hip and the pelvis done. And then from there, it obviously goes down to the knee. But to be honest with you, I can't find where the joint of this is. This is an enormous bone. As you can see, the surfaces on there are just incredible. You can see the wear and tear. It must have been quite an old giraffe. So it's not only judging from the size of the bones, but also just the... I'm gathering it would just be from the smoothness of those joints. Although, why I'm saying that, I wouldn't have a clue. I haven't played around with enough skeletons to actually figure out exactly how these things go. I don't know if it goes down onto this bone. or if it'll go down onto this one. I don't actually know. Good question. But just to give you an idea of what this looks like, I mean, have a look at this. This is one of the leg bones, one of the arm bones. I mean, easily as thick as my arm. Not that I've got the world's thickest arms anyway. I think it would be a better judge if I put them against Jeandre's calves. We definitely know he's got the biggest calves on the face of the planet. So anything smaller than that, or equal to. And then we've got a jawbone, just the one side. Bottom jaw. Have a look at those teeth used for grinding. Have a look at that. Now these are all the edges that they use to grind the plants that they eat smooth. All those little ridges there are cutting ridges, grinding ridges, making that cellulose as thin as possible. And you can see it's made up of premolars and then molars. No incisors and no canines. And this would have been used in a circular motion. You've seen the bottom jaw of those animals go down in a circular motion, cutting away at that plant material. Quite solid. Not as solid as a rhino, for instance. I mean, the bone density here on the legs and the pelvis, the bone density is incredible. This thing must probably weigh easily about 10 pounds. It's a quite a heavy bone there, but the jaw not so much. And then we've got the vertebrae, and we've got from quite large vertebrae to quite small vertebrae. And there you can see some of the weight-bearing vertebrae. That's where the spinal column would have come through. This is the crest, so this would have been outside. The back muscle would have been inside here. On the smaller one, the back muscle, you'd have one back muscle coming this way, one back muscle coming this way. Spinal column through the middle. And these are the two different sizes. Quite a lot of them. This is how they would have fitted together. I obviously don't have two that fit, but they would have fitted together like this, and the spine would have moved like that over the socket and the ball there, and would have kept that spinal column, stopped it from overextending, and obviously the muscles would have stopped it from overextending this way just by being a little bit too stiff. How amazing is this? Now, generally, as a rule of thumb, you shouldn't really play with carcasses like this. We don't know what killed this carcass. I would imagine that the lions actually killed it, to be quite honest. The bones are all lying in pretty much the same place. Hyenas haven't carried off this, and it looks to be very old. I don't know. We've tried to collect as many as we could, but you can actually see from just around us over here what this looks like. It's an incredible collection. Some rib bones. This is a rib. So this would have been here. See how wide a giraffe's body is compared to mine. If I were to do this, you can see that. Much bigger ribs than me. So some rib bones, some vertebrae. We've got one jawbone. These are all leg bones. Pelvis, other leg bone. Here we have some more vertebrae here. It's quite interesting. Let me walk over there to you. These look like they fit very close together, as you can see. They even slotted. Can you believe it? Look at the top here. They even slotted. And that's very close. Have a look at that. How interesting is that? I've never seen that before. And obviously, they serve some purpose, and I would imagine that these would probably be somewhere close to the thoracic region, i.e. where the neck joins the body, so that it can allow for maximum compression. But you can start to see the tunnel that the spinal column goes in. And then turning it here, you can see the mobility. These wouldn't have been very mobile at all. In actual fact, they almost could be fused. That's about as much mobility as I'm able to get in this one. Is that. So these would have been limited mobility. Hence me thinking this is where the neck joined the body, the thoracic vertebra. Interesting, eh? And another one would have fitted on this side. No, these two are made to go together. They don't fit on the other side. Very interesting. Anyway, that's these. With these, we've got some more rib bones. We can't find a head anywhere, to be honest with you. And I'm busy looking for the skull. So the skull is so far eluding us. We've had this crime scene right here. There we've got some there. Come with me, Jeandre. Let's see if we can pick out. There's some bones lying all over the place here. Obviously, as the predators, or as the predator would have finished, they would have dragged off portions of this carcass all over the place. And then we have another piece of vertebra there. Oh, we've actually got two crime scenes here. We've actually got two crime scenes here. We've got this as well. And this looks like to be the head of a nyalo or a kudu. Before it starts, this is a ram or a bull. And this would have been before it starts. This is a young one. Before it started to curl too deeply. And you can also see old. Have a look inside there. There you can see the axial or axis bone that the head is on. And inside there you can see the brain cavity. Reminds me a lot of myself some days here when I look into this brain cavity. Empty on most occasions. Now what is quite interesting here is we've got this very sensitive smell. When I look inside here, I don't know if you've heard us talking about the Jacobson's glands, when animals, in particular lions, are phlegmon. They pull their lip up and that flares glands in the roof of their mouth. And those glands are very close to the brain and tucked, jam-packed with sensory organelle. And if you have a look inside here, I'm almost certain we can see the pits that they come from. And when I turn it, you can see that those pits are here, right at the back of the nasal cavity, and where the tongue would be lying is underneath here. And there you've got those pits going through into the brain. Have a look. You can see, I'm going to cover a couple of them. You'll probably be able to see my shadow. Can you see the shadow? No. But they definitely go through. You can see there. There's, if you look down, this would have been looking into the nasal cavity. This is the nasal flanges. And look over there. There you can see direct access plugging into the brain underneath the eye socket. There would have been the eye. And there the optic nerve goes through to the brain. This would have been the eye, optic nerve. So definitely not the giraffe skull that we've been looking at, but nice nevertheless. Interesting things you find lying around here in the bush. So back to what we're busy finding here. We've got another one of the giraffe bones there. I can see another giraffe bone there. So we've got quite a wide area here. We'll just carry on having a look around here and see if we can find the skull. The skull of the giraffe will actually tell us whether it is a bull or a cow. And if it's a bull, we should be able to see quite some interesting things on it. Obviously, the most remarkable will be the very big ossification of those of the skull themselves. Bull giraffe don't stop producing bone on exposed areas on their skull. And they get these massively developed heads that they use as a hammer when they're busy fighting with one another. Let's just have a look around over here. I think this is more of that kudu. This looks like to be something associated with the kudu's knee. Although once again, my anatomy lessons are failing me here that I had at university. All right, I can't see anything more. I'm going to circle back and pick up my rifle, because that I've forgotten in the bush in my adventure to try and find you the rest of the skull. Alright, and while we try and track my rifle again, which is somewhere here where this giraffe skeleton is, don't worry too much, we're going to be linking through to Brent.
So, welcome. Unfortunately, it seems like every set of tracks we find this morning is departing from our traverse area. But I have heard of a possible set of tracks going into Juma, so I'm making my way there now. So we tracked with great, great excitement for a very short while. What was definitely Mr. Anderson. A massive leopard track, like a side place. Looks like a lioness track. Unfortunately, crossed south out of our traverse zone, and we crossed tracks some more lion tracks. They also crossed south. So I have heard now from my friend at Sibambili that it looks like the rest of the Nkuma pride, so only two of them crossed earlier, and they are now with four Birminghams and a buffalo kill on Chitwa Chitwa. But I've heard now that sometime this morning, it looks like the rest of the three lionesses might have crossed from Sibambili, so I'm trying to head towards that area and see if hopefully we can pull a cat out of the bag before the end of the sunrise safari. So Karula's got an impala kill in Little Gowrie. Both babies are there. Four Birminghams, two Nkuhumas on a buffalo kill, Chitwa Chitwa. Talala Pride, those are the tracks we're crossing. They've gone south. The Mangen Pride or Talala Breakaway Pride, they've gone west. And I'm not sure what happened with those male leopard tracks that Sam was following. I've had a malfunction here. So Tamara is wondering, do I know where the Ottawa Pride is? Yes, apparently they were with the Majinga line males. Tomorrow, the Ottawa Pride is very far from here. They don't. They're one of the prides that has not ever come up here. And if they do, it'll be right on the western edge of Elephant Plains, so an area we can't go. So they are down in the Sand River in the western sectors around an area called Inyati, last I heard. So the Ottawa Pride, I actually used to see them many years ago when I was at Sagisa, but I have not seen them since. They don't really come here, so they're probably, as the crow flies, 12 kilometers that way, or even more behind us that way. So a non-pride we're going to be looking for this morning. One must remember that the Sabi Sands is over 130,000 acres. There are lots of different prides of lions, and some of them come up here and some of them don't. Morning, Ken from Iowa. He's wondering what's about the highest and lowest elevations in our traverse area. Our highest is probably around just under 500 meters above sea level, and the lowest probably being just around 420, 430. So very undulating, not great difference in our elevations around here. So very undulating areas, sort of low hills, no massive outcrops of rock or whatnot. Now there are some of those in other parts of the Sabi Sands, but not in our traverse area. And as far as I know, if I can think of, none in the what is classified as the northern Sabi Sands. I think the closest sort of rock elevation, which would probably put it at about 700 meters, maybe not even, probably 650 above sea level, is just to the south of Arethusa and in Londolozi, and then there's another one in Malamala, which would be the south of Cheetah Plains. But unfortunately, none of those where we can drive. We're probably heading up to about our highest elevation here on the Arethusa-Sibambini cut line. And they are at most just over 500 meters or so above sea level.
Of course, Jeandre is just busy showing off at the moment with this absolutely beautiful footage of a mercury drop spider living in the tent web. And you can see that mercury drop, where it gets its name from, that bright silver abdomen that she holds quite erect. It's quite a bizarre, basically, the way she's holding her abdomen. A lot of spiders generally just hold their abdomen out to the back of them. She tends to have an abdomen she holds up straight, and then it's got this weird deformity on the top as well. But this isn't why we stopped at this particular spider. What we have found is a tropical tent web spider with the spider and her egg sac. And this goes to answering a question a little bit earlier as to how long spiders live for. And this mommy spider, she's coming to the end of her life. She's had a very good season, and she is now, she's a bit sensitive for me. Can you see her moving off there? Okay, I'm going to have to show you where she is. She was just sitting on her egg. She's just moved off. She obviously caught sight of me. But this is the egg at the end of the grass here. That's her egg sac. That's a silken capsule. And she has her eggs in there, and it'll stay in this position for the season. It'll then hatch, or the spiderlings will hatch at the beginning of next season. They will crawl out of this egg sac onto this branch. They will then crawl all over these branches. And what they'll do is they'll sit on the end of the branch, and they will spin a very, very thin tail of silk that comes out of the back of their abdomen, and they will then, it'll get caught in the wind, and the wind will then drag them off the branch and pull them into the air, and that's how they disperse from their egg sac. Now I can still see the mom, but it's going to be very tough from your angle there to see her. She's behind this branch here, but right at the base of that on the tree. You might have to come this way, and then I'll point her out to you. Just going to show you mom. She's in a beautiful condition. So at the end of my grass, there is mommy, tropical tent web spider. You get her. Just her abdomen, basically. We're just trying at the moment. Bear with us. This camera work is quite a tricky thing to get right, especially at these funny angles that we got at the moment, and with animals that are as camouflaged as the ones that we are filming here at the moment. This tropical tent web spider, she has an abdomen that looks exactly like a dried up piece of bird poo or something like that, a leaf perhaps, or a seed capsule. Isn't that amazing? You get to see her. Now, she's quite a large mom, and I'm gathering that's why we're seeing her egg sac in such good condition. I haven't seen any other tropical tent web spiders with egg sacs like that. She's now just hiding over there. She obviously saw me approaching and went down close to the base of the leaf, just in case she thought I was a big animal. Obviously, animals out here, they deal with elephant and rhino and hippo and giraffe and kudu and all manner of different types of animals. And so they have these ways of protecting themselves. They'll protect themselves, sacrifice the web a little bit, come make repairs, and then carry on with their day. And that's what she's gone and done. But isn't this fantastic? So an intact end of the story, end of season spiderweb tail that we've got over here is that tropical tentuous spider, her egg sac, which shows she's at a good season, and then the kleptoparasite. I didn't quite catch the question there, Laura. I thought that you asked that, do spiders spin webs, or do all spiders spin webs? Do they eat their webs? No, Laura, not all spiders eat their spider webs. In actual fact, it's quite rare for spiders to eat their own webs. The bark spiders do it, and some of the spiders that are, some of the spiders that are a little bit more specialized, they also do that. I'm going to show you, this is some prey here. We've got a nice shot of a fly here. And this is exactly what that spider is waiting for, is a fly to come. Fly just like this. One of the thousands of flies that make my day very difficult. And that fly would fly and become entangled in the entanglement snares, fall into that web, boom, and she'd come up and bite it. So no, just to finish off that question, not all spiders eat their webs. In actual fact, it's quite rare for spiders to eat their webs, but spiders that do eat their webs regain some of that lost. I suppose spider silk is not never ending, and spider silk is made of something that spider potentially has the physiology to try and reclaim. Or it forms some sort of nutrition. It is a water-based substance, spider silk. So it does form some or other type of, nutritional value. I'm not too sure. But definitely not all spiders eat their own silk, and these ones don't eat their own silk either. But these plants have been a fascination for me for this late in the season. This is a Waltheria, and generally on these Waltherias, we have found the most bizarre things over the walks of the last few days. I'm trying to find something in it now that gives it to us. These plants grow in sea plants. We have a spider exoskeleton, that's about it at the moment. So apart from the thousand flies that are buzzing on my head at the moment that I just want to smash into smithereens, we've also got an exoskeleton here. Right there is a spider, an old skin of a spider. So what's happened here is the spider's gotten too big for its body. It's then popped the lid off the top of its, basically the top of its abdomen, top of its thorax, excuse me, and it's climbed out, pulling its legs and everything with it, leaving its old skin behind and then growing into its new skin. Oh, we're surrounded by some elephants around here. We've got some elephants coming to us from our right-hand side. Jennifer's asked us a nice question about how old was this spider, this eastern tropical tent web spider. Jennifer, I'm going to say that's probably came out at the beginning of the season. I would say that she was probably born around about October, November. We started to see our first spiders here. We had some early season rain, and so they came out around about October, November, but it could have been as late as December, but October, November of last year, that's how old this spider is. Some spiders do get older than one season. As I was mentioning a bit earlier, the baboon spiders definitely can live for up to 30 years in some cases, depending on the material that you read. For now though, I need to rub my head and try and get rid of some of these flies that have been giving me short circuits here. Right, now we've got some elephants. We've got some elephants that are calling at us, at least anyway. I don't know if they're calling at us, but they're definitely trumpeting off in this direction over here. So even though I can't see elephant, I do know that there are sounds of elephant coming from this direction. It didn't sound like a bull elephant, it sounded like a baby elephant, and a baby elephant nagging its mom for some milk. And that means that we're going to need to be a little bit more careful about when we're walking through here. Although I've been talking quite loud, and we haven't really been paying much attention on the bush at the moment, we're definitely going to be keeping our eye open, or weather eye open, keeping our senses a little bit more extended. But while we do that, Sam has got an update for you, and I'll see you in a bit.
3, 2, 1, you are live. Welcome back, everyone. It seems that we've managed to find an eagle or a hawk of some sort that is in the tree there. You can just see its head moving there. I think it's a gymnogene, so it's inside that tree, which is a very, very cool bird to see. Hopefully it'll get up and fly away for us and we'll be able to see that magnificent wingspan. Yes, I think it is a harrier hawk. See, we just saw the front of the face there. It's a beautiful bird to see, the gymnogene. See that white coloration? He's got that reddish bill in the front there. Just while we watch him there in the distance, I'm just going to get him in the book just in case no one knows what a gymnogene looks like. But it's not the best visual of them. There he is. I'm just going to that page. So I just went looking for him in my book here. It is a gymnogene. But some books have them under harrier hawk or gymnogene. So I'm just having a look here where I can find it. So it doesn't seem to be here. What I'll do is I'll get a picture after we're done here. Let's just get a good sighting of the gymnogene from the distance, and then I'll see if I can find it in another bird book. So what I can try and do is look under African harrier hawk. So just watch that bird while I see if I can find it. So I used to have a harrier hawk in Cape Town. So you can often see them in Cape Town. It's really cool to see them here now. It used to be my friend's best favorite bird. Here we go, I've just found it. So here it is. So that's the gymnogene that we've just seen, next to Mr. Ellie here. The African harrier hawk, otherwise known as the gymnogene. So you can have a look at that bar coloration. That's what I saw in the distance when I looked at the bird. So when we do go back to the bird, let's have a look at what we can see. So let's have a look and see if we can see that gymnogene again. There he is. So it looks like he's sitting up in the tree. So they sometimes get confused with gabar goshawks, because gabar goshawks also have quite a stripy front at the brunt, otherwise known as barring. And it's what's also quite fascinating is that their facial skin, so that red bit that we saw in the front of the face, I'm not sure if you guys can see that there. I can see a little bit of red there, but that facial skin blushes red when it's excited or threatened. How interesting is that? It actually gets redder when it's excited or threatened. At the moment, it looks very relaxed up in the tree there. It might be sitting at a perch looking to hunt something. So it's right by the watering hole. We are by Buffelshoek Dam, just seeing if we can find anything. We've seen elephants everywhere. Well, we've seen elephant dung everywhere. So yeah, you can see the dung, some dung here, and it's pretty much all over the watering hole. So what we're gonna do is just gonna see if we can get into another position to view the African harrier hawk and see if we can find some elephants, because I can't tell you how many tracks I've seen with dung everywhere. So we're gonna reposition to see if we can find a nicer view of that harrier hawk. In the meantime, let's go see how Steph's doing.
And I know we've been doing a lot of spiders today and over the past couple of weeks, and today's no exception. We're doing mostly spiders. And have a look at the spider that we've managed to find on this branch. Here it is here at the end of my finger. And it's the most unbelievable green color. And I found it because of this funny white silk that she's spun. And it doesn't look like, to be honest with you, I don't actually know what spider this is. It's not a green link spider. She's definitely got quite robust chelicerae and fangs, which are her mouth parts. They look like they're designed to kill things that are quite big. There she's gonna walk now. Let's see if I can turn this slightly so that you can see her better. Can you see her there, Jeandre? Jeandre is instructing me to hold it nice and still, which of course I have to do. But have a look at that lovely green color. It's obviously camouflaged. She's a little hunter, a stalker. Generally camouflaged spiders are hunters and stalkers. But then she's got this funny silk. You might find that this was an egg sac. I'm not too sure. So this is an unknown for today. Unknown spider, unknown egg sac, unknown type of silk. I've never seen this white fuzzy silk before. Have a look at how beautiful that spider is. Eyes quite high up on the top of her head. Quite a fast moving little spider. And is now ducked under some cover. There we go. And there she's camouflaged herself. You still see her? There she's camouflaged herself. And I mean, virtually invisible. I know that she's there. She's dragged her legs into an off spider position, which means that she's dragged her legs into a position that doesn't actually look like a spider. And that's that. We're going to leave her hidden and send you back to Sam, who's repositioning for some ellies.
So we just came and found that harrier hawk, and that harrier hawk was getting mobbed by some of the fork-tailed drongos. So maybe we can find them again. It was on this tree right here. And we're just gonna follow this to see if we can find that harrier hawk again. Just flew off literally just before he came back. And he was getting mobbed, absolutely mobbed by the drongos. So maybe we might just be lucky to see him again. So we are on the road that takes us north towards Buffelshoek cut line. Can't see him at the moment. So the elephants can still be heard in this area. There we go, found it. There we go, awesome, well done there, Wium. So what you just saw there, we just got a good glimpse of it, quick glimpse of it. It was the harrier hawk that was then being mobbed by the drongos. So let's go back in that direction, because it seems as if the harrier hawk has now moved back in that area. Awesome, I'm so glad we managed to see the harrier hawk. It's fascinating behavior when you see a harrier hawk getting mobbed, or any kind of eagle that gets mobbed by the smaller birds. And it's mainly the drongos that do this. It's very, very fascinating to watch. Let's see if we can find him again. I think he could have come back towards the tree that he was at earlier. So let's have a look. So this is the tree that he was in earlier. So it doesn't seem that he's there anymore. Let's just have a quick look around though. Harrier hawk, not in that tree. So it looks like the harrier hawk has left us this morning, but we can still, well, I've just been hearing the sounds of elephants trumpeting, and if you look at, on the other side of the watering hole there, you'll see that there is dung of the elephants pretty much all around that watering hole. So let's go up and follow up and see if we can find those elephants that are moving through the area. I would love to see an elephant this morning before the morning is finished. nice and cool down here by the water. There's a bird there that just flew across there. I think it could be the pied wagtail, but just to make sure, let's see it, because I know some of our birders, such as Aaron and James, would love to get a new bird to their list. So let's just see what that is flittering around there. Looks like the pied wagtail. It is the African pied wagtail. So we have that on our bird list already. I just thought we'd maybe have a quick little look to see what birds we might be able to fill up on your list. Is that a new bird for you, James and Aaron? I hope so. If not, no worries. How many other people are filling up their bird list? Please let me know. I'd love to know who it is, and we can work together to try and grow our bird lists, make them a little bit bigger. So that was actually a new bird. That must be a new one. The gymnogene, of course. I don't know if you've got the gymnogene. I've already got it. I got it a couple of weeks ago. But maybe Aaron or James or some of the newer viewers that are starting their bird lists, write down gymnogene or African harrier hawk. And always, I think, is a good practice is sometimes write a little fact about the bird that you might learn. So, for example, we learned that the African harrier hawk, its facial skin gets a little bit redder. There goes a waterbuck that's just by the watering hole. You can't quite see him now. He's moving off into the distance there. So we're going to move back into the area, see if we can find any elephants. Harrier hawk that its face gets a little bit redder as it's threatened or is excited, and it'll help you learn a little bit more about the ecology of birds that we have here at Juma. So the signal might dip for a second as we go down into this little dip, so just it might just happen. This is where we once saw that pregnant female. The lioness in this thicket, she was lying up just over there, and I was pretty sure that she was, well, she looked really, really, really pregnant. And the last time James saw her, which was a couple days ago, she was still hadn't given birth yet. So maybe she's given birth, maybe she hasn't. I'm really not sure. Those cubs might very well be on the way any day now.
So, disappointing news. We found tracks of those other three Mkuhuma ladies, and they went to Buffelshoek. So that means we have tracked three or four sets of lions this morning, Dave?
Four
sets of lions, and one set of leopard tracks, and all of them have left our traverse area. But if they leave, they've got to come back at some point. So we will remain eternally optimistic that something is going to appear. Now, I'm taking a gander, a little bit of luck, because Sam did have those male leopard tracks up around Vuyatela Axis, Sandy Patch this morning. Now, if it is Tingana, he might have ducked into these really thick drainage lines here just to the west of me. So I'm hoping for a little bit of luck, and I'm gonna head towards the Galago Pine. Sometimes he likes to come down one of those big elephant paths out from the drainage lines before making his way into this area. But I don't think anyone's checked there yet this morning, so fingers crossed, even if there's a track that we can follow up on the sunset safari. But this is the African bush, and that's what happens. The animals are not confined to the same boundaries we are, and that's wonderful for them this morning, not so much for us, but as we say, you never know what could be around the next corner. There could be a leopard we've never seen before. There could be a random male lion who's marauded in from Kruger. So, even if there are none of the big cats, there's always amazing and interesting things to look at. And it has been an absolutely beautiful morning. I mean, when I say there's not a cloud in the sky, there is literally not a cloud in the sky. Warming up quite nicely now. So we're not the only ones looking for lions on kills. Sam has got another creature who makes its bones by looking for lions on kills.
Have a look at this white-backed vulture that's literally flying above us right now. Incredible, look at that, those wings. It couldn't be closer to us. So we saw it flying from a distance and we've just seen it circling the sky. As you can notice, it doesn't even need to flap its wings. It just floats and uses that long, long wingspan to just move in the air. It's an incredible, incredible shot of a vulture flying above us. And it's starting to get warmer. It could very well be that vulture that we saw earlier that's just taken flight and is now finding some of the warm thermals, which the rising warm air off the earth to start rising in and seeing if it's anything in the distance here. So it looks like it's been sticking in this position for quite some time. We saw it come from about 2 kilometers away. And it flew straight towards us and flew above us like this. Maybe it's come to say happy birthday, this white-backed vulture. Beautiful. Vultures truly have such a stunning glide that they have. I really love looking at the feathers. So if it does come back around us and you can see those feathers quite nicely, it might be worthwhile to do a screenshot. Just to have that, like that, that's beautiful, look at that. With the blue in between those long primary feathers. It just seems like it's circling an area. So vultures can often tell us and help us identify with different things that might be out here in the bush. So we went from an African harrier hawk all the way to a vulture. Wasn't that special, and it's still above us, so let's follow it a bit further and see maybe what it might be looking for. Can't see it anymore, there it goes off into the distance. So hopefully this afternoon if I go to Arethusa or Cheetah Plains, whatever it is, I'll see if, ooh, no ways, this is incredible. I've just seen through the trees here that there's some white-backed vultures and a number of them. There could actually even be different vultures that are on that tree in the distance there. Let's go and have a look, investigate what might be happening in this area. And as I said, we spoke about dead knob thorns a bit earlier and how animals or birds like to sit and rest on them. So let's see if we can get a good shot of them now. Fantastic. So that white-backed vulture drew us closer to the group of them. I'm just going to get sit in that position like that there. So that just spotted that in the corner of my eyes. A number of white-backed vultures that are sitting on an old dead knob thorn tree. Just going to check that all of them are 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7 and one in the sky. In the far distance there, so there could be something down below that tree, but it also might be, I mean, I'm just getting to know vultures more and more and understand their behavioral patterns now, and I know they start getting active in the mornings and start looking for those thermals to then potentially find some prey. But what's quite fascinating is the social group that we have here, because the other day while sitting with one vulture in a nest, and they only raise one vulture at a time during the winter season. So the winter season's coming up now. So hopefully we'll go back to that nest a little bit later and we might just be able to find during this winter season at that nest something. Anyway, it's been a fascinating drive. Thanks everyone for being part of it on my birthday drive, turning 26. It's been great. We've just ended the show off with some nice birds that have given us a little bit more knowledge around the experience of them. But let's go and see how Brent is doing with an elephant this morning, and we'll see you for the sunset safari. Cheers for now.
So, no male leopard, but a female elephant having a feed in the thicket. So, at least we got one ellie before the end of the safari today. Munch, munch, munch on the bush willows. Almost looks like she's clearing a passage so we can see her better. And there's quite a few ellies I can hear behind her, but it's a very thick area they're in. I can actually see a little one's tail wagging behind her. No, not her tail, there's another one behind her there. But it has been a gorgeous morning so far. Not too much action, but that's the way it goes in the bush. Oh, it looks like she might come closer to us. That would be very nice. Now, they're not too far away from the Juma Dam Cam, so definitely those Juma Dam Cam aficionados, keep a lookout. Quite possibly be some water drinking action later on the day. And you hear the grey go-away birds complaining about something as they fly over us. It seems like all the elephants were in the thickets this morning, not out in the open. Maybe up on the crests where it's slightly warmer. Forward or back, Sam? Dave.
Just back, maybe.
I heard Sam talking on the radio in my ear. Here we go. I think it's going to be quite a warm day. Well, X-Ranger says, Sam is the positive squirrel, and Brent is our positive tracker. Oh, excuse me. There we go. So definitely keep a lookout on the dam cam during the day. I think there should be some nice elephant activity as it warms up. Probably around between 11 and 12 Central African time in these cold winter mornings. It is definitely a favorite time for the elephants to go drink. Even a little bit later, up till sort of 1, 2 is also good. But Dave and I were discussing why we're lacking in cats at the moment. And I think I've figured it out. I think it's my weak attempt to grow a winter warm beard. So I think as soon as the beard or attempt at a beard comes off, we're going to get a little more cat sightings. Oh, she's coming out into the open, is she? Looked like she might move towards us. Forward slightly. I find a window. Oh, she is coming this way, so let's go back a bit. See if we can get Dave a window. We can enjoy it. Big elephant. That's nice. There we go. So there she is. And literally just a window through the bush. It's nice, straight ivory. A left-handed elephant, or a left-tusked elephant. See her left tusk slightly shorter than the right. Sniffing, sniffing, sniffing for something to eat. Always nice to end with an animal, and I know an elephant. The elephants are firm favorites of a lot of our viewers, and definitely a firm favorite of mine. So, as I said, been a bit of a quiet sunrise safari, but by no means less beautiful. The The weather was stunning this morning, starting from very cold and warming up quite quickly now. But from myself, Dave, and Stef and Jeandre, and the rest of the crew, we'll see you in a few short hours, hopefully for a sunset safari inundated with animals.